Welcome to worship this morning among the folks of First Baptist Amherst and in our building. Welcome to you who are visiting from near or far away, and to you who visit with us online, live. I think our live stream is working today. I'm grateful for people like Marlene and today Sharon, who helped that keep going on Sunday mornings for us, and the recording that stays with us. You can go back for months and months and watch the service if you need to. But today we are here live and in person with the living God. Let's sing our introit, our opening song. Greetings in the name of Jesus Messiah, Son of God, the Savior.
Christ is the builder of the home, the church, throughout time and space.
For centuries, the people of God have sung responsively,
praising and giving thanks to the Lord.
For he is good.
And his steadfast love endures forever.
With hymns ancient and modern, let us continue the songs of praise. I'm calling this Hymn of the Month. It's going to be for 3 weeks in September and October, whatever. We'll call that a month. But a hymn from a book that was the book in the pews at Digby Baptist that I learned there. And Kevin got interested in this summer. So let's sing this hymn. It'll lead us into our readings from Philippians in the weeks ahead. At the Name of Jesus.
Thank you.
Please be seated with me and let's speak in prayer together the prayer at the bottom of our first page. We bow to you, O Jesus, and submit to your power and goodness, grace and perfection. In your name we gather, by your power and by your authority. Be real for us here. We praise you by doing many things together, praying, singing, listening, giving, caring. By your Spirit, show us the way into the Scripture story, following the children of Israel. Teach us, inspire us, challenge us, move us. Hear the cries of our hearts and answer. All this we pray as we begin to you with the Creator and the Spirit, one God. Amen. Our song before and after the children's time is an old spiritual that fits with the story of the Exodus we're about to hear. But let's remain seated and sing the first couple verses here of when Israel was in Egypt's land. Well, today we have a very nice lunch laid out, warming up downstairs in the Christie room for everyone. And I think there's enough for two helpings for all of you, because there's ham and baked beans and brown bread, coleslaw, I'm trying to read lips, and all sorts of squares. I made some bee sting bars, which you should really try. But do you like ham? When I was a kid, I didn't like ham. Do you like baked beans? When I was 11, I didn't like baked beans. Do you like coleslaw? I've always liked coleslaw. I've got something else that I baked. You might want. Do you like biscuits? I like biscuits. Do you like my biscuits? I've got a dozen or 16 of them here. And they're all about the same. One Sunday, about 6 weeks ago, I was getting ready to do all the Sunday morning things here, and I thought, I'm going to make some batch of biscuits. So it was 8 in the morning, so I mixed up the biscuits, and I put them in the oven, and I was putting around and doing this and getting my stuff and getting dressed, and came down here and was getting ready, and it was before choir, and I thought, I need that little dongle thing that goes in my laptop computer to show the slides. So I made a quick trip home in my car, and when I went in the door, I could smell, was the smell of biscuits that were not quite burning, but were quite toasted. And there were the biscuits after about 2 hours in the oven. And here they are, and they don't go bad. But would you like a biscuit? No? You don't want one at lunch today? I think you've got much better things. But these children of Israel, in the story, they're about to cross the Red Sea and start their long journey to the Promised Land. It's going to take 40 years, as you might know. But one of the first things that's going to happen to them afterwards is they're going to complain about the food. They don't have all the nice food they had, even when they were slaves in Egypt. But they did have leeks and onions and garlic and cucumbers. And they don't have that when they get out into the wilderness. They've never been in the wilderness before. So there's food they don't like. Now, each one of us has foods we like and some foods we can't even eat. Even if I forced you to eat a biscuit, some of you are gluten-free, so I wouldn't be able to do that to you, would I? But we have a lot of preferences in our lives, and we do have a lot of blessings. I think most of us probably get enough to eat week by week and day by day, even if we don't want to eat ham or a burned biscuit. But we're such a variety of people, and we need to think at times our God is going to teach us to think about the little bits of complaining we do at times, just even with the food we don't want to eat. That's perfectly good food, not that. The perfectly good stuff. And we learn about complaining when we're in trouble from the stories of those Israelites in the desert, too. There's so much to learn about how to live well together, how to respect one another, how to listen to someone else complain, and how to complain ourselves, and to temper that a little bit. Because on a day like today, we've still got most of us, I think, have our electricity. I haven't heard of anyone that doesn't, and we've got food downstairs waiting for us. We have so much. We need not complain, because there are other parts of the world that have a lament in their prayers for God because of the troubles that they have. So, with thanks for the wonderful goodness of our promised land around here in Nova Scotia, let's think of those who need more hope and more freedom and even more food as we sing that last verse of this old spiritual.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
This morning we are reading from Exodus 14, verses 19 to 31. The angel of God, who was going before the Israelite army, moved and went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord, in the pillar of fire and cloud, looked down on the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into a panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so that they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth, As the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a water for them on their right and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great work that the Lord did against the Egyptians, and so the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses.
And our psalm today, printed here responsively, reflects on that very event. Let's have this conversation. When Israel went out from Egypt,
the house of Jacob from a people of strange language,
Judah became God's sanctuary. The sea looked and fled. The mountains skipped like rams. Why is it, O sea, that you flee?
O Jordan, that you turn back?
O mountains, that you skip like rams?
O hills, like lambs?
Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord.
At the presence of God, Jacob.
Who turns the rock into a pool of water?
The flint into a spring of water.
Amen. Now let's hear a word from the New Testament, as Sharon shares from Romans 14.
There's so many obstacles here.
There is. Welcome.
Welcome to you. Reading from the book of Romans, chapter 14, starting at verse 1 to 12. Accept him whose faith is weak without passing judgment on disputable matters. One man's faith allows him to eat everything, but another man whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not, and the man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does. For God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls. And he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One man considers one day more sacred than another, and another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. And he who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. For this very reason, Christ died and returned to life so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. You then, why do you judge your brother? Or why do you look down on your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me and every tongue will confess to God. So then, each of us will give an account of himself to God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Our brief verses from Matthew's Gospel will lead us into our prayer of forgiveness, our little conversation that's printed in the bulletin. A scene with the disciples and Jesus. Then Peter came and said to him, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, "Not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. As Hildegard prayed, we pray. Holy Spirit, making life alive, moving in all things, root of all created being, cleansing the cosmos of every impurity, effacing guilt, anointing wounds. You are a lustrous and praiseworthy life. You waken and reawaken everything that is. For the failures and harms of our lives, we pray, seeking inner healing by 2 things, by your grace and by forgiving others in all the time and space of our lives. Eternal One, Shepherd of our souls, to you be praise for all the freedom from wrong you have brought. In Jesus, amen. Well, today is to be the annual Terry Fox Run in, I'm sure, thousands of communities across Canada. Here in Amherst, it was canceled. I don't know if that was the weather or what that was about, but some of us ran yesterday morning when the weather was worse, I think. Anyway, I don't know if I dare say this right now, but I've become a bit of a runner this year, but I've yet to participate ever in a Terry Fox Run. I do have 2 t-shirts from an annual local run called Not Since Moses. Once a year on a low tide, hundreds run along the beaches of 5 islands at the low tide, for 5 or 10 kilometers. There's the t-shirt from 2008. All these runners run along the low tide beach, along the cliffs and all, before the unstoppable tides come filling in that space with water, water, and more water. I love that Minas Basin landscape. I've lived near the Minas Basin of the Bay of Fundy just about all my life, I guess. I've been exploring the Parsborough Shore and around Economy and all across Hants County and Kings County and all over the place. This summer, again, I walked over at a low tide in 5 islands over to Moose Island, and I camped there overnight, as I've done before. I've been known to take friends with me out there and to, at a super low tide in the summer, to guide us by walking and doing a little bit of wading in the water to go by Diamond Island and around Long Island and out past Egg Island and Pinnacle Island and right around the Pinnacle and then rush back before that tide really starts coming in again, or else you're going to be stranded on an island that you might not want to be stranded on. This summer, I walked out at an Economy Point, walked 3 kilometers out, way out on the sandbars to get as close as I could to that a little red island out there called the Brick Kiln, but there was still some water in my way. I could watch the tide come and go on these beaches for hours. In fact, sometimes I do get to do that. It's very dramatic at these places. At Thomas's Cove in Economy, there's a veritable tidal bore that comes along the beach. We're used to this maybe in rivers, but it comes right on the beach too. When you think about it, it could be quite scary, especially if you're out in some sandbar, some rock, and all of a sudden you're surrounded by the swirling water that just isn't going to stop. So the story of the children of Israel, that's so famous, crossing the Red Sea or the Reed Sea or whatever we call it, is one I can picture. I can imagine. I can imagine it happening in 5 islands or something like that almost. And maybe you can also. It is a story. a Bible story, we've really just read part of it today, of rescue and freedom, yes, but it is also a story of death and destruction. After years of enjoying our immense tides and the ebb and the flow, I know and you know how dangerous this all can be. This year in Nova Scotia and beyond, waters have flooded and have destroyed and have killed. Far too much, we'd say. After our dry, burning spring we were having, the waters started flooding down and in some ways have just never stopped. Not to mention other places, the deadly recent flooding in Libya, for instance. In the book of Exodus, we just peek in today at the dramatic moment when the Israelites escape across the empty bottom, that route through the sea, and then the pursuing Egyptian army gets flooded and drowned. We read, Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore, which is good news for them about their enemies, right? That's the way they saw that, of course. But what would he say? Not since Moses has anything like that really happened on the earth? Not since Moses in the days of the Bible has the Creator intervened in such miracles? Stopping and starting rivers and oceans, pausing the sun or the moon in the sky for a while, instigating earthquakes to swallow up evildoers, turning the sky to darkness when there was a crucifixion happening. But how do we expect help in the face of flooding rains, in the face of furious fires, in the face of the latest earthquakes and droughts? How do we pray? How do we expect our God to respond? People differ in their opinions upon this. Christian people differ in our understanding of this, how it makes sense, what we expect. And it's quite important to us. When the largest forest fires strike in Nova Scotia and many more scar the landscape of Canada, pray. When chains of thunderstorms cross the province and then hurricane season begins, pray. When nearly 3,000 people die in the recent Morocco earthquake and at least 11,000 in the Libyan flooding, where are you, O God? People would pray. It's not as simple as say the right prayer, get the right blessing, is it? My own real short answer to this is I don't know. I don't know how prayer works and what God will and won't do. But it's well worth having the conversation and keep it up with the Spirit of truth and power. And I'm very grateful when good things come our way. I say thanks. So our text today from Romans 14, I think, is helpful. What Paul was writing about was not our situation, but the principles apply, I think. Don't despise those who differ from you. The diet of the ancient Jews and early Christians was clearly important to them, eating meat or not, and so forth, and had religious and spiritual implications for them. But it's not likely one of our issues. For believers now, the role of women in church and society is an important issue. Yes, it still is an issue in church. In August, we Baptists just elected our first woman as our executive minister, Reverend Renee McVicker. Our president for this year also happens to be a woman, Dr. Lois Mitchell. Now, other Baptist denominations with churches around us would still do no such thing. And yet we are still siblings in Christ with these other believers, with these Baptists who differ in their teaching. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister, asks the scriptures. We may pass judgment on someone's ideas and teachings and practices using some wisdom, but not upon the people themselves. Another example, last weekend there was a wedding in Annapolis County, and Sharon and I were invited because we knew the bride and groom, and he was someone we knew who was a fellow member of the Digby Baptist Church with us. But we did not get to the ceremony. I kind of wanted to get there, but it didn't happen. And I was also kind of disappointed and concerned because the wedding was held at a local Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I guess so. My own personal judgment is, I mean, I'm biased because I'm a Baptist minister, but that's a dumb move. But yet in Christ, I think I need to keep loving and respecting these folks that I know who just got married. One more example. I noticed recently my mother's reading a book by Philip Yancey. I think it's maybe his one of his memoirs or autobiographies, Where the Light Fell. I remember reading one of his books years ago, and he spoke about his upbringing and his father. When Philip was young, his father became ill with polio, which in those days was certainly going around. And in fact, he was ill enough, he had to live in an iron lung, if you remember all of that. The family was very Christian, very devoted, very conservative. And the church and the family believed that with faith and with prayer, Mr. Yancey would be healed by the Lord. And so they turned off the iron lung. And he died 2 weeks later. You might say that not since Moses have such healing miracles truly happened. Or you may not be such a skeptic like I am sometimes. And you can testify to unexplainable healings and answered prayers, great prayers that were answered. I mean, in our own family, Sharon especially speaks about our granddaughter who was born at about 1 pound. She was 3 months early being born and was in the hospital a long time. And how many miracles and miracles and miracles and miracles happened every day and every week to keep her alive. And now she's a happy-go-lucky 6-year-old in primary school. Miracle of miracles, Jesus has all of us together with others in other pews and other places in the family of God. Despite our wondrous differences and attitudes, our different beliefs, our different questions or answers, there is a role to guide and to help other people, of course. But the spirit of correction, I call it a spirit of correction, can be harmful, can be too much too often. A flood of opinions may spill from our mouths and even just from our eyes at others. Our discipleship to Jesus gets us trained to be just that much more gracious and patient with others and not judgy. Perhaps that last line in our reading from Romans means a great deal. We are accountable to God far more than to one another. When it's all said and done every day, we are not the judges of those around us. If we are a school of spirituality, here we learn not to pass judgment. Our training with Jesus has been from the little things to the greater things in our lives, perhaps. We let go of judging others for how they want to, you know, rearrange the chairs on the Titanic, in the parlor or something. And then we move on to being free from judging how others want to pray or to sing or to serve God. And then we graduate up to stop judging people for making different conclusions about how their life is to be lived, ethics and morals. Not that there's no conversation, but there's less being judgy. The great balance between not judging others and helping others find a better path is a balance we can walk but by the grace of God, shown to us in Jesus the Christ. Welcome those who are weak in faith, it says in Romans 14. And may I be ready to face the fact that my great faith is also simply weak. The God who died and lives again is the real giver of strength and faith. Amen. Let's observe a moment of meditation. The ushers prepare now to receive the offerings of the congregation on this mid-September Sunday. In his Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." Let us pray. Father of the heavens, we do dedicate the offering of the congregation of us to the name of Jesus, that his authority may be over it and his power make our work that much better. In his name, amen.
Thank you.
You will see in the large bulletin information about upcoming events of ministries of us and of others, and pray that you make the most of your opportunities. And some of these things you might be prayerful about, even if you're not a participant. The usual routine of things is happening. We're into September, and all the usual stuff is going on. Our English classes and our hopefully singing at White Birches and all these things will happen as scheduled. So do take note, take it and read. With our whole lives in mind, we pause for praying this beautiful mystery and power we call prayer. So let us begin. Oh, pardon me. Let's not begin. Let me pause, because I'll get a hymn book thrown at me if I don't announce one thing that's not in the bulletin that's happening at the mall, at the A&E Center at the mall. Tomorrow evening, 6 to 8:30, is the Bordertown Jam Gospel Night, including this mystery choir I've never heard called the Travelers. And you've been around forever. Some of you are part of this, the Travelers. But the Travelers will be there. And I can't go to hear them, I guess. So you're going to have to keep singing, and somewhere I will hear the Travelers. But it'll be worth traveling to hear them tomorrow evening at the mall. Let us pray. Eternal One, on this last Sunday of summer, you are the guide for all our transitions. As schooling begins, as cottage time ends, as days shorten and the final harvests begin, we find your presence in Jesus among us, training our hearts and hands for all our tasks. Teach us to pray. Give us faith in this kind of conversation. We pray in the midst of the troubles that are real threats. We remember the disaster of the earthquake in Morocco with nearly 3,000 casualties. We call out for mercy and help. We remember the flooding in Libya, where up to 11,000 are dead and that many people are homeless now. We cry out for comfort and blessings to rebuild. We know the problems brought by Tropical Storm Lee in the Maritimes this weekend, and as cleanup begins, protect those doing difficult and dangerous work. Amid the storms of life, we give you thanks and praise, Holy Spirit of God, for the blessed work going on. Today is the day of the Terry Fox Run across Canada. With our local run canceled, let this inspiring activity go on and support the healing and help of all those facing cancer. For us, in a season of so little ministry compared with seasons of the past here at First Baptist, we pray for our search committee and for the pastors who have applied to serve as our minister of families and outreach. Help us find the ways of your guidance, O God, that they will shine through in our own thoughts and our vision. As we keep in prayer those who are shut in or isolated, those mourning or distraught, those who are ill in any way or injured, those who are seeking treatment and help, may your blessing be upon our local healthcare community mourning the sudden death of a medical doctor. And among us, bless our Board of Deacons in their oversight of our church's spiritual well-being. And now, in this moment, give us grateful hearts as we identify two new honorary deacons, Ed Cahoon and Susan Cahoon. All this and more we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I do turn things over now for this business and this celebration of deacon ministry. I'll turn it over to this fine couple.
must be moderated.
Vice moderator.
Welcome.
I was just thinking that in these last decades, Cindy and I have shared some duties together, but I think this is the first time we're conducting the church business together. Mine's a much easier job than hers. So as a result, I'd like to call the congregational meeting to order, and I'll let Cindy do what she does best.
I have an important motion to make, but first, a bit of an introduction. We are aware that the church, being more than stones and glass and wood, cannot act in the world or even in a small town without us, the folks who bring their hands and hearts to worship, to organize, to seek truth and share light. Occasionally, we pause to express deep appreciation for particular members in recognition of exceptional service to our church and to the Board of Deacons by awarding the title Honorary Deacon. Two nominations have come to the Board of Deacons, and we heartily approved to bring these names before the congregation. We are deeply grateful for the leadership of Susan Cahoon. I'll name just a few of her contributions. We recall Susan's challenge to us to sponsor and welcome Syrian newcomers and the community effort that followed those compassionate pleas. We admire Susan's commitment to the values and traditions of this church, acting as a representative in the wider Baptist community. Within the church, Susan has served 6 terms as deacon, most of those as chair. She has given service to the Sunday school, on CE, on nominating and search committees, not to mention her talents in hospitality, taking the lead in special events planning. As I said, just a few of Susan's contributions. If you'd hold Susan in your mind for another minute, the second nominee, Ed Cahoon. Ed's understanding of the historical journey of this church and of Baptists at large has been invaluable to this congregation, important even as we navigate changing times. We have benefited from his guidance in matters theological, giving voice to varied perspectives through small group book studies. We appreciate Ed's continued representation of this church in the Baptist community locally, particularly through CABF, also nationally for a term on the Canadian Council of Churches. Currently, Ed is serving as chair of the Board of Management, as well as his 8th term as deacon. Throughout their more than 50 years membership at First, that's a combined full century, Susan and Ed have given immeasurably of their time and talents to the benefit of this church. On that basis, I move that we, the congregation of First Baptist Church, Amherst, confer the title of Honorary Deacon, a lifetime honor, to Susan Cahoon and to Ed Cahoon.
You gotta wait. Okay, you've heard the motion, and Dave Harrison has seconded it already. Is there any discussion? Pretty straightforward. Do I hear somebody with a question? Good, thank you. All those in favor of having these two fine people as honorary deacons, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Motion passed. I didn't want to take names in that second part, so.
And would you come forward to receive your certificates?
Surprise. With such a short agenda, I declare the business section of the service closed. Thank you.
And thank you, Hollis. In a few moments, we will get to come down. And if you're a visitor, you're very welcome. There's tons of food down there. Bring people off the street right now, too, for lunch. But it's a time, especially for we who know each other, to appreciate one another for all the ministry pieces of the puzzle that we all take part in, as well as to celebrate Ed and Susan. Let's sing a classic rousing Welsh hymn as our closing hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah, in the hymn book and also printed the words printed in the bulletin. God, who called us together today, we give you thanks for our worship time together to your glory. Now we rejoice in table fellowship downstairs, for food in a world where many are hungry, for shelter in a world where many are vulnerable, for kind friendship in a world where many are isolated. We give thanks. May the blessing of God go before you. May God's grace and peace abound. May God's Spirit live within you. May God's love wrap you round. May God's blessing remain with you always. May you walk on holy ground. Amen.